Tonight is another part two with a former international cricketer. This time it is the turn of former Proteas bowler, Garnet Kruger. Garnet, good evening and welcome to Sports on the Full View.
Good evening, Busiwe. Thanks for having me again.
It's a pleasure. Okay, Garnet, so the last discussion we had with you, we touched on your playing career in general. Now, tonight I'd like us to look at some specific events. Let's start with the 2005 tour to Australia. At the time that this tour took place, you were in prime form, and yet you didn't get an opportunity to play in the test, which we can say were lost comfortably. Now, after that, did the leadership or management still make you feel that you had a role to play in the team despite not being involved in that test series?
No, not at all. There was, to be honest, there was no real communication. You must remember that I joined that team by way of force. I played cricket for probably 9 years up until that point where I was supposed to make my debut. I was with the squad a couple of years before that in 2003 against the West Indies, but I only joined the squad for one game at the Wanderers. And to be honest, also there was no communication. But from there on, I kind of knew that I'm going to have to work harder to get into the national team, because the environment at that time with Graeme Smith and with Mark Boucher, you could see already that there was something brewing, and I'll get to that at a later stage. So when eventually I broke down the door to play, at the airport already, I also felt that, you know what, I'm not really feeling comfortable, but, you know, I'm going to give it my best go. And why I say that is because on the cricket circuit, often my first time that I joined the squad, so from 2003, four season, when I was for my first time with the SA team, after that, on the cricket circuit, you could hear talks of, you know, some guys, other left-handers, there's gonna be difficult for them to play now. And obviously, my thinking is, if you perform, you will play. But there was other sides to that story. So there's a lot of left-handers that played during Graeme Smith's time that was also under pressure. I won't say pressure. They knew it was going to be tough for them to get into the team because they were going to put Graeme Smith's place under threat. And also as a captain, there was other guys that could have been captains as well. But they operated in a way that they could keep certain guys out of the system. So I joined the team, went to Australia, got there, also not much said, and I made a statement about that when I came back from the tour. But also I didn't, at the our first net session, had a bit of a jet lag, ran around, but you know, you also did not feel that it's a welcoming environment. And especially because you know the guys, so you play against the guys during the domestic season. But when I joined the team, you know, I just didn't feel like I was welcome. But nevertheless, I got on with it. We played the first warm-up game, and then I performed well. I got wickets. Second warm-up game, I didn't bowl a lot. I probably bowled one spell. Then I got pulled off. I walked around the field. And then obviously, you know, you get a feeling that you're not going to play the first test, although reports have made me favorites because of the form that I was in.
Yes.
But it wouldn't be that way. I didn't play the first test at the WACA. And then they drew. Eventually, I thought, okay, because nothing serious happened, No, I'll see. I think I'm going to be lucky if I play the second test match. But as it might have it, well, we all know I didn't play the second test match as well. And that was the one that South Africa lost.
Yeah.
And I was really hoping that I would play the third test match in Sydney. Although I knew that because of reports, I've never played that, but that was going to be one of the wickets that would less suit me. But nevertheless, I was still prepared and I was still hungry because I've been there now close to 5 weeks. And I originally wanted to play test cricket. That's the format that I've produced and did well in South Africa prior to me being selected.
Garnet, I'm just going to cut you there quickly, just because I want us to get through the crux of a lot of questions that I've got for you. In your answer now, you touched a bit about the leadership within the team itself. Let's talk about the relationship between a wicketkeeper and a bowler. Obviously, a very, very important relationship, especially if one is new to the team and one has been in the team for a longer time. How was your relationship with Mark Boucher?
Well, I can, for instance, one incident, and it was early on in the tour, we were bowling at Mark Boucher in the nets, and I know it was myself and Andre Nelston, and the nets is very spicy. So we were bowling a bit short, and he was very uncomfortable. He hated it. Instead of him helping us, he told us to pad up, and he's going to hit tennis balls at us. So that is just an example of the type of help that I would get. Amongst the leadership, there was nothing, no communication. But I think that was because they knew I wasn't going to play. I would bowl in the morning. I would bowl during lunch breaks to Abuta Dipanar and to guys that are not playing. But we would go alone. The bowling coach or whoever the coach wouldn't even come with me or, you know, only in the morning when the guys are warming up, then probably I would have. So there was no real communication whatsoever, especially when it comes to me. Nobody wanted to take me under their wing, especially from the hierarchy leadership. Myself and Makaya, we spent a lot of time together. We obviously also spent a lot of time together. But that was it. No Mickey Arthur, no Vinnie Barnes, no bowler relationship with a wicketkeeper, especially from my side.
Yep.
I've never really had a serious cricket chat with any of them.
Okay, so now looking at a national team composition, obviously it comprises of different players from different backgrounds as well as walks of life. How was your relationship with your then captain, Graeme Smith, on that particular tour to Australia?
Yeah, like I said, we didn't really have a relationship. We would probably chat if it's a team function. I knew we had to take a photo at the airport. That was also a bit of a struggle because they were, I think him and Mickey were busy talking about the tour. And I was a new guy on the tour. There was a photographer waiting. And we had to struggle to get the attention. So in terms of my relationship with Graeme, to be honest, we never really had any form of relationship. We never spoke to how I'm going to fit into the team. There was nothing of that sort.
Which is rather unfortunate. Okay, I'd like to move our conversation in a different direction now. So your homeboy, Russell Domingo, is the first coach of colour to be appointed for the Proteas. Now, I want to ask you the question. Do you think that your former teammate, Mark Boucher, has the character to help with this transformation movement in cricket South Africa? And the reason I ask this question is because it has been said that his character is one of the main reasons that he's been chosen ahead of the likes of Geoffrey Toyana or Enoch Ngwe, who have both the qualifications as well as the silverware for the job.
You know, there's a lot of stuff that the public don't know about, and obviously there's other people involved. Mark Boucher is actually not a suitable coach, and I know it seems harsh, because from my point of view, They were the problem when most of the guys tried to play for South Africa. They were blocked. And now, obviously, they are in certain positions of power to make certain decisions. And on the other hand, if they want to talk about transformation and helping, they don't know anything about transformation. They, to be honest, I don't think they care anything about transformation. That's why we need to get players that know how to talk to certain players and how to handle players from certain walks of life to make sure that they feel comfortable in the team environment, and that in team environment is a loving, caring team environment where players can grow. And that is not what Mark Boucher is about. Like I said, there's a lot of stuff that the public don't know about Mark Boucher and about our cricketing heroes. I think it's time that South Africa finds out.
100%. We need to have these open and honest discussions so that we can bring about the change that's required in the sport. Now, just speaking about Mark, are you surprised by his silence during this time? Because he is the national coach and will have to really build an environment in the marquee team of the country that will make everyone believe that they have a chance, and not only have a chance, but have a fair chance.
Yeah, so to be honest, that we need to find a way to come together as South Africans and work on our problems. The first problem is that they're going to have to admit that they've been wrong, because the evidence is going to prove that anyway. And then we're going to have to decide how we're going to go about fixing our cricket top to bottom. And that is, we need to start with our Minister of Sport. Then obviously it's going to have to filter down to CSA. And then, obviously, once that gets sorted, I'm sure that the playing side will take care of itself. But at the moment, there's too much ill treatment going on in our cricket. And like I said, South Africa needs to find out, and that is what we're going to try and expose. But we are also keen to grow cricket, to work with Cricket South Africa, to work with anybody, but not on their terms. We're going to have to come to some agreement that certain stuff get put in place and certain stuff get done. Because for us to work together, we're going to have to really work together. We're going to have to put our heads together and solve this problem of inequality and racism in our cricket and in our sport and just in life in general. Because I feel it's time that everybody gets treated equal. If you treat people equal, you will get the best out of them anyway. And I think South Africa deserve to be World Cup winners. But for some reason, we have something hanging over our heads. And I think this is it. This is going to show its head now. That is why we don't have the cricket gods on our side.
And now I want to give you a scenario, Garnet. When you have two roses and one grows on concrete and another grows on fertile ground, why are we still surprised when one of those roses comes out broken? And I suppose my question here is the system fair to all players who are privileged enough to go to academies or even get provincial contracts?
Let's just go back to the basics. Let's go to grassroots. Is the township cricket in the township? Are the kids from the townships getting fair opportunity to show their skills? Like I said last week, we were very fortunate in our area, but there's areas where CSA know they need to go and develop, but they're not doing it. They talk so much about the KFC program. The KFC program, to me, is actually non-existent, because they are not reaching all the areas that they should be reaching. And that is where we need to start. So from the onset, there is two totally different standards, and I'm a product of it. As you can see, we are talking here, now you are talking to me, not to tell you how wonderful CSA is or the cricketing system is. It's a broken system that we need to fix.
Okay, now just as we're wrapping up, you signed a contract with Coalpack and you made it official that you were done with your country of birth. Tell us about how you arrived at this decision and how you actually communicated it to your family.
Actually, I must just say all of the above. All of the above. Because my dream was to play South Africa, you know? And I came to the conclusion of signing a Coalpack deal the minute I knew that I wasn't going to play for South Africa. And I realized that when I came back from the from my tour to Australia, when there was a follow-up tour where Australia came back at the end of our cricket season in March, April, and nothing. The only call I got was after the 4-3-8 game, to talk about the incentives that they're going to want for the TV rights or for the rights of that game. And then the test series started, but that was the only time. So after that meeting at Sandton, I walked after the ball, I said bye and I left, and I never heard anything again from anybody involved with cricket at the national level, whether it's a selector, CEO, anybody. And that's how I came to the conclusion that, you know what, I'm going to have to try somewhere else. And because I played two ODIs, I was fortunate enough to be able to get a Coalpack deal. But, you know, I played there for a number of years, and I can honestly say I enjoyed my time there. I learned a lot. But yep. Deep down, I still wanted to play for my country. So I decided to come back and try again. But obviously the same people were still in power, and I just died into the dust.
Your story is so inspiring, and I'm so happy that you as cricketers, former cricketers, are coming forward and you're having these open and honest discussions, because these need to happen in order for change to come about. And with that, we have unfortunately run out of time, but thank you so much for having time to talk to us this evening.
Can I just say one thing? I would like to know what's happening with the current players that's in the setup. How do they feel in that setup? I think it's time that they also start talking. And that's all that I have to say.
100%. Thank you so much, Garnet. We will be bringing through some current players and hearing their side of the story. Hopefully they have the courage to speak their truth. Have a good evening.